Liberation now meant provision with life's necessity, the abolition of what then was called unhappiness, the creation of bonheur, happiness. And this word, it was duly noted, was a new word in Europe. It meant, in short, the solution of the social question, and finally you have there Robespierre exclaiming, La République, la monarchie, je ne connais que la question sociale. The Republic, the monarchy, I know only the social question. And Saint-Just, who had started out with the greatest possible enthusiasm for republican institution, added very curiously, the freedom of the people is in its private life. Let government be only the force to protect the state of simplicity against force itself. He might not have known it, he certainly didn't know it, but that was precisely the credo of enlightened despotism. And I'm going to quote to you, in order to make you aware of this, a one sentence from the speech of Charles I under the scaffold. He said, that the people, he said what he believed was true, and it was something which actually every enlightened despot, not the unenlightened one, but every enlightened despot thought about the matter, namely that the people's liberty and freedom consisted in having the government of those laws by which their life and their goods may be most their own. 'Tis not for having share in government that is nothing pertaining to them. If it was true, as all participants, moved by the misery of the people, suddenly agreed that the goal of revolution was the happiness and not the freedom of the people, and now it was Condorcet said, a revolution is a movement whose goal is freedom. And at the end, they said, le but de la révolution est le bonheur du peuple. The goal of the revolution is the happiness of the people. You see this complete change. Then it was indeed much rather a sufficiently enlightened despotic government that could provide it than a republic with freedom for all. It was, as I said before, the French and not the American Revolution that set the world on fire, because partly social conditions in the world at large were and still are by far more similar to the conditions surrounding the revolution in France, and partly because the sometimes overpraised Anglo-Saxon pragmatic tradition has prevented the post-revolutionary generations in the United States from thinking about the revolution and adequately conceptualizing its experiences. If you want to have any such immediate thought from the revolution, you have got to go back to Madison and to John Adams. You will not get it, or hardly get it, from any succeeding generations. Please think of what has been done in the matter of thinking with the French Revolution. I don't need to name names. It is therefore not surprising that the despotism, actually the return to the age of enlightened absolutism, which announces itself already in the course of the French Revolution, became the rule for nearly all revolutions that followed, and became dominant not only in practice, but in revolutionary theory. I don't need to follow this development into detail. It is too well known, especially, of course, from the history of the Russian Revolution. What is more, it could be predicted. It was in late summer of 1918, that is after the promulgation of the Soviet Constitution, but prior to the first wave of terror in Soviet Russia, which was of course triggered off by the attempt to assassinate Lenin, that Rosa Luxemburg, in a private letter which later was published as the Russian Revolution, wrote as follows: "With the repression of political life in the land as a whole, life dies out and every public institution becomes a mere semblance of life in which only the bureaucracy remains as the active element. Public life gradually falls asleep. The few dozen leaders of inexhaustible energy and boundless experience direct and rule. Among them, only a dozen outstanding heads do the leading, and an elite of the working class is invited from time to time to meetings where they are to applaud the speeches of the leaders and to approve proposed resolutions unanimously." 1918. "A dictatorship, to be sure," she added, "not the dictatorship of the proletariat, only of a handful of politicians." Well, this is how it turned out to be, except, of course, for Stalin's totalitarian rule, for which, however, I think it would be difficult to hold Lenin or the revolutionary tradition responsible. No one is likely to deny. But what is perhaps less obvious is that one would have to change only a few words to obtain a perfect description of the ills of absolutism prior to the revolutions. Now, I have dwelt at some length on the French Revolution because the same facts and experience have appeared in nearly every revolution ever since. A comparison of the first revolutions, whose beginnings were so similar and whose ends so disastrously different, demonstrates clearly, I think, that the conquest of poverty is a prerequisite for the foundation of freedom, and that the liberation from poverty cannot be dealt with in the same way as the liberation from political oppression. For, theoretically speaking, if violence pitted against violence leads to war, foreign or civil, violence pitted against social conditions has always led to terror. And terror, rather than mere violence, terror let loose after the old regime has disappeared and the new regime has been established in power, is what actually sends revolutions to their doom, or deforms them so decisively that they fall back into tyranny and despotism. I said before that the revolution's original goal was freedom, in the sense of the abolition of personal rule and the admission of all people to public affairs. But rulership itself had once its most legitimate source not in any drive to power, but in man's wish to emancipate himself from life's necessity. And this was achieved by means of violence, by forcing the many to bear the burden of the few, so that at least a few could be free. This was the core of slavery, at least in antiquity. And it is only the rise of modern technology and not the rise of any new political ideas, including revolutionary ideas, which has changed this human condition, at least in some parts of the world. What America had achieved by great good luck, many, though probably not all, may acquire today by virtue of calculated, organized effort and development. And this fact, I think, is a measure of our hope. It permits us to take the lesson of the deformed revolution with their terrible consequence into account and still hold fast not only to the undeniable grandeur of such events, but to their innermost promise. And this promise is great indeed. Let me remind you once more of the Novus Ordo Seclorum, which took the new order of the centuries, which so clearly tells us to what an extent the revolutions were felt to be a new beginning. The surprising phrase is actually taken from Virgil, who in the fourth eclogue speaks of a magnus ordo seclorum, the great cycle of periods, I'm translating, that is born anew in the reign of Augustus. Magnus ab integro seclorum nascitur ordo. But he speaks of a great and not of a new order. And it is this change in the line, much quoted through the centuries, that is characteristic for the actual experiences of the time that lifted this from Virgil. For Virgil, to speak the language of the 17th century, it was a question of founding Rome anew and not of founding a new Rome, so that he could escape in typically Roman fashion the fearful risk of violence inherent in actually setting a new beginning. Now, we could, of course, argue that the new beginning which this first revolution thought they were watching, and actually were watching, of course, was only the rebirth of something very old, the rebirth of a secular political realm which finally arose again out of Christianity, out of feudalism, out of absolutism. But no matter whether it is a question of birth or rebirth, decisive in these last remarks, I think, of mine is that the line I quoted was taken from a nativity hymn, not, of course, prophesying the birth of a divine child as the Middle Ages believed, but praising birth as such, the arrival of a new generation, as a great saving event which will always salvage mankind time and again. In other words, it was the affirmation of the divinity of birth and the belief that the world's potential salvation always lies in the very fact that the human species regenerates itself constantly and forever. Now, what made the men of the revolution go back to this particular poem, quite apart from their erudition, I would suggest, was that not only the pre-revolutionary idea of freedom but the experience, the revolutionary experience of being free, coincided, or rather was intimately interwoven with beginning something new, with, metaphorically speaking, the birth of a new era. And obviously, this mysterious gift of man, that he can start something new, has something to do with the fact that every one of us came into the world as a newcomer through birth. In other words, we can begin something because we are beginnings. We are therefore beginners. Insofar as the capacity for acting and speaking is but another mode of acting, insofar as this capacity makes man a political being, and since acting has always meant to set something into motion that was not there before, birth, human natality, corresponding to human mortality, is the ontological condition sine qua non of all politics. This was known in both Greek and Roman antiquity, albeit in an inexplicit manner. It came to the fore in the experience of revolution, and it has influenced, though again in a rather inexplicit manner, what one may call the revolutionary spirit. At any rate, the chain of revolutions which have become, for better and worse, the hallmark of the world we live in, discloses to us again and again the eruption of new beginnings within a temporal and historical continuum. For us, who owe to a revolution and the resulting foundation of an entirely new body politic, that we can walk in dignity and can act in freedom, it would be wise to remember what a revolution and such an experience of birth, so to speak, the actualization of birth, means in the life of a nation. Whether it ends in success with the constitution of a public space of freedom or in disaster, for those who have risked it or have become involved in it against expectation even, it means the actualization of one of the greatest and most elementary human potentiality. It means an unequal experience of being free in making a new beginning, from which comes the pride of having opened the world to a novus ordo seclorum. Thank you.